Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. I'm going to try to pump up the energy. And in fact, I had a great idea for pumping up the energy level for this next panel because it's been a long day. And we're going to do it, or at least my idea was to do it as a Mad Lib panel where, you know, each speaker would give part of a sentence and then throw it open to the audience to finish the sentence. And the feedback I got was that idea was catastrophic. So unfortunately, we won't be doing that this time, but let's just put that in the great ideas for another time file, shan't we? Hey, it's great to be, I just got back from a couple weeks in England, and it's just so great to be back here where English is spoken. I've taken away so much from today. I think for me, probably the number one takeaway was just that image from Andy Crouch of the naked mole rat. Powerful. In this panel, we're going to be focusing really on the international dimension of justice and dignity and human flourishing. We have three different perspectives here. I am the moderator, coming from the Gates Foundation, so a private philanthropy. And then we will have others speaking from the perspective of a Christian faith-based organization, and then from the U.S. government. So there's not actually a private business represented here, but as it turns out, a lot of Rich's background is in the business world. And the Gates Foundation benefits from a successful business that led to its creation. And a business, I would add, which does not use a biblical symbol of original sin, unlike some of the competition. Although it turns out King David did have some issues with Windows. So on that lofty note, let me introduce the first of our two panelists, Victor Boutros. Victor is a prosecutor with the U.S. Department of Justice, where he investigates and tries a number of kinds of cases, but those include international trafficking cases. I should say both of our panelists work on both domestic and international issues, but for this panel, we're really going to focus more on the international. So Victor is a member of DOJ's Human Trafficking Prosecution Unit, and he has worked on cases in many different regions of the world. You can see his full biography there. Many of you will be familiar with the book, which he co-authored with Gary Haugen of International Justice Mission, The Locust Effect, which came out earlier this year. Victor?
Well, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be with you and to share the stage with two very distinguished colleagues. And I want to thank also the AEI team for all the work that went into convening us together today. Most of us probably have some kind of mental picture of what it's like to be very poor in the developing world. Maybe visual images pop up in your mind of the grave challenges confronted by the poor. The child with the distended stomach, maybe shanty houses or dirty food or water. If you spent time in the developing world, you know that it's not hard to see the evidence of abiding problems of hunger or homelessness or illness. Poverty's grind. What is harder to see, but is no less a part of the experience of the poor in the developing world, is poverty's terror. The way in which the global poor are daily threatened by violence. This is the hidden plague of our era that is quietly devastating the hope of the poor, the everyday reality of common, lawless violence. The relentless way the average poor person in the developing world is threatened with being enslaved, imprisoned, beaten, raped, or robbed. In the new book that we released with Oxford Press earlier this year, we call the devastating impact of everyday violence on the poor the locust effect. History is full of horrifying stories of poor farm families who are forced to watch helplessly as a plague of locusts suddenly descends to devour their crops, and in a matter of hours destroys years of effort trying to plan and plant their way out of poverty. Likewise, it seems that we're approaching a pivotal moment in history where if we do not decisively address the plague of everyday violence that swarms over the common poor in the developing world, the poorest will not be able to achieve their dreams ever. This is the locust effect. But here in North America, you and I are so used to breathing the invisible oxygen of law enforcement that it's hard for us, I think, to even imagine what it's like for billions of poor people around the world who don't have a justice system that protects them. That is until a year ago, when the horrifying 911 recording of a young woman in Oregon gave us a glimpse of what it actually feels like to live without law enforcement. This young woman had been hospitalized just a couple of weeks before from a violent assault by this man. And now she's home alone on a dark weekend night in her rural county in Oregon, and he's back. He's yelling threats at her, and he begins to rip and tear his way through her window to come into the house. Terrified, she did what we all would do. She called 911, where she suddenly learned that due to budget cuts, police were only available on weekdays. But this was a weekend. And as the helpless 911 operator explained, quote, "It's unfortunate you guys don't have any law enforcement out there." Listen to this excerpt of the 911 call.
"I don't have anybody to send out there. Okay. You know, obviously if he comes inside the residence and assaults you, can you ask him to go away, or do you know if he's intoxicated or anything?"
"I've already asked him. I've already told him I was calling you. He's spoken before, but down the door assaulted me."
"Is there any way you can safely leave the residence?"
"No, I can't, because he's blocking pretty much my only way out."
"Well, the only thing I can do is give you some advice and call the sheriff's office tomorrow. Obviously, if he comes in and unfortunately has a weapon or is trying to cause you physical harm, that's a different story. You know, the sheriff's office doesn't work up there. I don't have anybody to send."
Sadly, I have to tell you that this man did tear his way into her house and tragically choked and beat and raped this young woman. We have to confront this stark reality. This is what happens when there is no law enforcement in your area. And this is the experience of the world's poorest. In fact, the UN tells us that this horrific nightmare represents a way of life for 4 billion poor people who, quote, live outside the protection of the law. If you're a poor person in the developing world, you wake up each morning knowing that you will have to navigate the daily threats to your life in functional lawlessness. But what does this everyday violence look like? The largest and most pervasive category of violence against the poor is gender violence. That is sexual violence and domestic violence against women and girls. It's the story of Lucila, a very typical mom who lives in the Andean town of Huanaco, Peru, which is this utterly unremarkable place, except for the little known fact that it had a rate of rape that seemed to exceed the worst reports coming out of war zones of the Congo. Lucila's mom was a victim of domestic violence. Lucila herself was driven out of her own home by violence, and her own 8-year-old daughter was brutally raped and murdered and dumped out onto the streets. The World Health Organization has found that the locusts of gender violence kill and disable more women and girls between the ages of 15 and 44 than cancer, malaria, war, and car accidents combined. The plague seems to be worse in Africa, where we met Laura, who lives in a slum in Nairobi and has been sexually assaulted by 3 different men by the age of 10. Just as the world is waking up to the amazing way that poverty can be reduced if girls are sent to school, studies now show that one of the chief reasons girls don't go to school in the developing world is violence. Violence on the way to school, violence at school, or violence at home. The second massive category of violence keeping the poor in poverty is forced labor. In Bangalore, India's booming high-tech capital, you and I could go and sit with Mariama and a dozen former slaves as they described what it was like when the locusts of slavery descended and swept them into a brick factory compound where they endured sadistic beatings for 12 to 14 hours a day without pay. The Global Slavery Index, which was released just last October, documents that there are nearly 30 million people in slavery today. That's more people in slavery today than ever in history. In an era of exploding growth in some sectors of the developing world, there is a massive sector of humanity that is literally held in poverty by force through slavery. A third devastating category of violence that threatens the poor is police abuse. This is the story of Caleb in Nairobi, who's just walking his young kindergartner to school when he's randomly picked up in an extortion sweep by the local police. They throw Caleb in the squad car and force him to leave his little son abandoned in the street. He doesn't have enough money for a satisfactory bribe, and so Caleb spends the next year in prison. He's tortured by the police, who are desperate to extract a confession in a robbery case they're under pressure to solve. Meanwhile, the locusts of abusive police descend on Caleb's home, ostensibly to do a search, and they search his house and devour all the money that Caleb and his wife have been saving for their older daughter's education. As a result, in a moment of crisis, the poor in the developing world don't run to the police, they run from the police. The fourth category of violence that devastates the hope of the poor is the violent theft of their land. Experts have documented that the poor's most precious asset for climbing out of poverty is usually just a little piece of land where they can build a shelter and grow some food. But on a chronic basis, millions of poor people are left destitute when the bullies in their community descend and swarm down to violently throw them off their land. One of the groups most vulnerable to this abuse is widows, who in poor countries collectively support 500 million orphans. Constance is one of those widows in Uganda. Like millions of other widows in Africa, Constance found herself and her children cast into desperate poverty simply because she was violently thrown off her land. You can see why we're calling this plague of violence in the developing world the locust effect. It's because of the way that it has the power to devour so much of our efforts to assist the poor, and the way that none of those traditional efforts can stop the swarming violence. The medical clinic, for example, is of no use to the slave like Mariama who can't get out of the brick compound to go see a doctor. The new schoolhouse is of little use to a girl like Laura who can't walk to school without being raped. The microloan for the new sewing machine is of no use to a family like Caleb's if the police can simply steal the proceeds from the new business. The new high-yield seeds and farm tools are of little use to a widow like Constance, who now has been thrown off her land. Moreover, none of the medical clinics or schools or microloans or farm tools can stop the violence. While our traditional approaches to poverty can't stop the violence, there is a very fundamental service that can. It's something that you and I depend upon every day to keep us safe from violence, but something that the poor in the developing world almost never see. And that, quite simply, is law enforcement. In Bolivia, for example, if you sexually assault a child, you are literally more likely to die from slipping in the shower than to go to jail for your crime. Likewise, in India, if you hold someone in slavery, you are more likely to be struck by lightning than ever be sent to prison. What's becoming manifest is that after 50 years and $3 trillion of poverty alleviation efforts, we skipped a step. We have failed to build a platform of basic law enforcement in poor communities that will allow the poorest to hold on to the benefits of our aid. It's not that poverty alleviation efforts haven't worked at all. Clearly they have. But we seem to be reaching the limits of what can be achieved without finally addressing the most intimidating aspect of poverty, the plague of everyday violence. Now, I know this is a pretty dark and depressing picture, but in the book, we talk about some powerful rays of hope that are breaking through the cloud cover, and we can talk more about that in the Q&A if you're interested. Thank you.
And now I'd like to call on Rich Stearns. Rich is the president of World Vision, has been since 1998. He started his career, as you read there, in the private sector at Gillette and Parker Brothers, then Lennox. Rich, a few years ago, authored the book, The Hole in Our Gospel, which I think many of you are probably quite familiar with. Rich?
Thank you, Tom, and thank you, Victor. It's pretty intimidating to be at this pulpit after all of the pulpit lectern. There were a lot of preaching here today. After all of the distinguished speakers we've had, I may be the only one up here that either can't sing like Johnny Cash or doesn't have a PhD or an MDiv or is a federal prosecutor or in the Justice Department, but I'm probably the only one that's been president of a toy company. Now, could you imagine getting paid to be the president of Monopoly and Nerf balls? But 30 years ago, that's what I was doing, and I'm living proof that God has a sense of humor, and God has a way of redirecting our lives in amazing ways. And as Tom said, I've been at World Vision now 16 years after about 25 years in the corporate world. So I'm really glad to see so many young people here and to see their interest level in the topics that are discussed today. And it's exciting to those of us that have been in the battle for a few years. I want to talk kind of up in three directions this afternoon, and I made no effort to coordinate my comments with Victor, so it may seem a little disjointed, but we'll probably play off each other a little bit in the Q&A, and I support everything Victor said about the rule of law and how important that ingredient is for those of us that work in the poorest places in the world. But I first want to talk a little bit about the biblical framing and the worldview behind what we do. I want to talk about the problem, the very messy problem of poverty and injustice in the world, and just a few comments about the role of the church in tackling these global issues, and maybe some of the impediments that are standing in the way of the church being truly effective in tackling these more global issues. But let me start with this framing of the issue. It really comes down to worldview. And if we don't think about worldview, if we don't understand why we care about injustice and why we want or feel compelled to help the poor, it's just a very important thing, because that will determine the lenses through which we look at these problems, and those lenses will determine the diagnosis that we put on these problems, and of course the diagnosis will determine the treatment. So if you got the wrong lens, you might come up with the wrong diagnosis and you might come up with the wrong treatment for the issues of poverty and injustice. And I published a book last year called Unfinished, and it's really a book about the unfinished work of the kingdom of God, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the kingdom of God. And I feature in the book three worldviews or ways of life in our world. If you look at our world today, I want you to think about these three different constructs. The first I call the magic kingdom view of the world, and it's essentially a theme park view of the world. And in case you can't figure this out, the United States is very much part of the magic kingdom view of the world. We live in a place that is safe, that is secure, there's unlimited opportunity. We have all kinds of resources and wealth and educational opportunities in our country. We've got a stable government. We've got a rule of law, except in Oregon. Wasn't that where the woman lived, in Oregon? Yeah, very close to Seattle. We might have the same issues. But in the magic kingdom, we kind of look at the world as a place to enjoy, because we have a relatively safe and stable environment. And even in our founding documents, we talk about the pursuit of happiness, which I think Eric Metaxas is going to talk about tonight at dinner, the pursuit of happiness. And we pursue it in a lot of ways, with our vacations and buying a new car and traveling and enjoying good food and restaurants and music and arts and entertainment. So we live in this really wonderful and amazing world that I call the Magic Kingdom. And here's the thing about the Magic Kingdom. It's open to everyone. It's an equal opportunity employer, except for the fact that you have to be born in the right country and you have to have enough money to buy the admission ticket to the Magic Kingdom. Everyone else is pretty much excluded. And you know, the concerning thing about, there's so much good about our society, but we and the Church of Jesus Christ in America are marinating in kind of this magic kingdom view of the world. And what it does is it insulates us from the pain of the world. It insulates us from the very distant problems of ISIS and Syria and war in Congo and slavery in India and places that seem so far away that that 98% of Americans will never go to those places and never see those problems up close and personal. So we have to be careful if we live in a magic kingdom society because of that insular nature of the way we view the world and the way we view reality. Well, the second worldview, or the second kingdom I talk about, is the tragic kingdom. And mostly because it rhymed, magic kingdom, tragic kingdom. But it's the world that Victor has been talking about. It's the world of poverty and vulnerability and injustice and exploitation. We know the numbers. 2 billion live in extreme poverty. 18,000 children die every day of stupid, preventable causes. Bono calls it stupid poverty. Hunger, thirst, disease, child mortality. I've been to communities around the world where 25% of the children are dead by their fifth birthday. You know, my grandson just went to his first day of nursery school this week. But if he lived in another country, he'd probably have about a 1 out of 5 or 1 out of 4 chance of even making it to nursery school and preschool. It's a world of gender inequality. It's a world of injustice and exploitation, conflict, religious and ethnic conflict, violence, corruption. All you have to do, certainly in the last 3 months, just watch the evening news if you want to get depressed. Or if you want to get a glimpse of the tragic kingdom, just watch the news and what's happening from Gaza to the border crisis of children fleeing from Honduras and Guatemala and Nicaragua because of the violence in their countries. You go to Syria and Iraq, unspeakable violence, unspeakable hatred, Ebola in Africa. I mean, it's all around us. Probably more so in the last 3 months, it has broken into our consciousness than I can remember in the last few years. You add to that the notion of fragile states in the world. There are about 47 countries identified as fragile states, but they represent about 19% of the world's population, but about 50% of the world's poor live in these fragile states. And increasingly, poverty is retreating into these fragile states as we have more and more success in stable countries. Countries like Ghana and Zambia and Botswana that are relatively stable and have relatively stable governments and developing economies. Those are places where poverty is being chased out. And we're actually winning the war. There's a lot of good news about global poverty that I could share with you. So when we've got the low-hanging fruit of poverty picked, we will then have to go into the places like Afghanistan and Syria and Iraq and the Congo and South Sudan and the most fragile states in the world, which also have the problem of being violent and inaccessible and difficult to get to. And rule of law is a huge problem in those states. So if you look at this dichotomy, you've got the magic kingdom on the one hand and the tragic kingdom on the other. The one word that kind of describes the difference is disparity. It's economic disparity, it's a disparity of justice, it's a disparity of opportunity, it's a disparity of expectations. What can you expect? You know, my little 3-year-old grandson has unlimited expectations about what he can become because he was born into a country where you could have expectations like that. And of course, there's also a disparity of outcomes in the tragic kingdom. Now, as Christians, we have to look at this kind of disparity as unacceptable. You know, Jim Wallace this morning and Tony Hall both quoted Matthew 25. I was going to read from Matthew 25. I was hungry and you gave me to eat. I was thirsty and gave you to drink. I won't do that because it's been covered. But that was the vision of Jesus for a different kind of worldview. Not a magic kingdom, not a tragic kingdom, but rather the kingdom of God view of the world. And that's the third kingdom, which is really what motivates us. Now, if you read scriptures, you see that Jesus was a man who was literally obsessed with this notion of the coming of the kingdom of God, the coming of the kingdom of heaven. It's mentioned more than 135 times in the New Testament. Most of those mentions are by Jesus himself. And I wish I could go into more detail on it, but it was a different vision of the world. It was a different vision of human flourishing. If you read the Sermon on the Mount, what it is, it's a vision of a different kind of kingdom, a different way of human beings living together in a vertical relationship with God that's been restored, and then in horizontal relationships with one another that have been restored and transformed by the power of the gospel. And this different view of human flourishing based on biblical principles of justice, of forgiveness and reconciliation, of compassion and generosity and integrity and community. All of this is part of the good news of the gospel. And here's the thing. It is the most powerful form of evangelism available to us. When Christians live in those kinds of communities, when we live in communities characterized by forgiveness, reconciliation, compassion, integrity, generosity, people are attracted. People want to know, what do you have that we're missing? And so this was the view that Jesus had about the coming of the kingdom of God. My shorthand is the Great Commission, making disciples in all nations, and the Great Commandment, loving our neighbors as ourselves. And in the book of John, he said, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. In other words, we are a sent people. We don't have the option of being in the lower left-hand quadrant of Andy Crouch's diagram, safety. And we're not vulnerable and we're safe. And we have some power, but we're vulnerable and we live in safety. We live in the magic kingdom. We don't really have that option. We have been sent to the broken places, to the hurting places. We are supposed to be like a healing balm on the sores of the world. That is the nature of the kingdom of God, moving out into the world, restoring, rebuilding, redeeming, repairing, literally showing the world a different way to live, a different way to live. So that is the vision that motivates World Vision. I believe it is the vision that should motivate every believer, that we are sent people and we're sent to deal with the brokenness in our world and to be winning the world back for Christ. You know, I was thinking about a metaphor of the blood. You know, Jesus talks a lot about the blood, and we celebrate the body and blood of Christ in the communion sacrament that we all share as Christians. And if you think about blood, it's not a bad metaphor for Christians in the world. Blood brings oxygen to the body, you know, and Christians should be bringing oxygen to society and to global politics and to the places where we go and we live. And the red blood cells provide oxygen, but they also remove wastes and they take away impurities. So think about us taking away the impurities in our societies and just cleansing our societies of the evil and replacing it with good. And then if you think of the white blood cells, they attack things that are threatening to the body or threatening to human dignity, threatening to us as image bearers of God. And those white blood cells attack infections kind of viciously. And when things go wrong and our white blood cells don't work, our bodies are overcome. And so you can think about us going into the world as reformers, almost like white blood cells, going to fight injustice, going to fight for the rule of law, doing these things in our world. Now, I want to shift in. I'll just take a couple more minutes, but the business of healing and dealing with the poor and dealing with injustice is incredibly difficult and complex, and we would be almost foolish to attempt it if God weren't in it with us. I have a phrase that I use a lot that when it comes to solving the problems of poverty, it is rocket science. And unfortunately, there are many, many churches in America that think it's simple, that think anybody can, you know, we'll send the eighth grade youth group into the middle of the AIDS pandemic and we'll fix it. We'll go for a week and we'll deal with an incredibly complex problem in a very naive and simplistic way. Poverty is rocket science. It is so much more than just what I call the hardware of software. The hardware of software is if we drill enough wells, if we plant enough crops, if we build enough schools, if we give enough microloans, the kingdom of God will come on earth and the lion will lie down with the lamb. And all of those things are necessary conditions to dealing with the poor, but they're not sufficient because poverty is a complex blend of dealing with culture and rule of law and governance and community values and gender relationships and all of the complicated software issues that hold communities back and prevent people from becoming all that God intended them to be. And sometimes we talk at World Vision about solving the puzzle of poverty, that think about it as a jigsaw puzzle. And one piece might be health, and one piece might be clean water, and one piece might be food and food security. Another piece might be gender. Another piece might be rule of law. Here's the thing. If you only have one piece of the puzzle, you can't solve it. You have to bring all of these pieces together to have a picture of a prospering community that all of these things have been addressed in the community. Their relationship with their government, their relationship with one another, the relationship of families to education, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so World Vision tries to bring this fullness, this holistic model of dealing with poverty on a cultural, economic, spiritual, and material level in communities. We do it over 10, 15, or 20 years in communities because you don't solve these things overnight. Now, I've already gone over my time. I just want to make three points about the church very quickly. The church, on the one hand, has the potential to change the world. The church was sent into the world to change the world, to reform the world. Jesus launched a revolution that the church was supposed to undertake. But there are three problems. The church lacks the expertise to truly address the issues of poverty and injustice in the world, because these problems require economists, hydrogeologists, lawyers, agronomists, public health experts, a host of other professional skills. And there are certainly Christians that have those skills, but they're not generally organized within churches against these issues. I was thinking, Tom, that the church almost needs something like the Gates Foundation, a consolidator of all of these skills present in the church that can kind of focus the efforts in positive directions. But we have 350,000 churches that are all acting alone, trying to deal with these issues. Number two, the church is not committing the financial resources required to carry out the kingdom mission. In what is the wealthiest country in the history of Christendom, we give 2.3% of our income to all of the work of the church, most of which goes to pay the salaries of our pastors and youth pastors and for the work that they do. And then our churches give 2% of that to all international missions of any kind. So 2% of 2%, which is about 6 cents per Christian per day, is what the wealthiest country in the world gives to help deal with poverty and injustice globally. We spend more on pet food and soda than we spend on that. And then finally, the church is not prepared to go into the difficult places like Afghanistan and Iraq and South Sudan. And as poverty moves into these fragile states and remains in these fragile states, the church is going to have to figure out a new strategy for carrying out the Great Commission and the Great Commandment. So I'll stop there.
Okay, so I think you got a wonderful sense of some of the issues that create the complexity involved in promoting human flourishing and dignity internationally. So what I'd like to do is take three questions as a group and then throw them over to our panelists, and then we'll hopefully have time for some more. So what I would ask is just, you just keep your question real succinct, introduce yourself very quickly, ask it very quickly, also make it good, and then we're going to ask our panelists to also answer pretty succinctly. So who's got a question? Okay. Okay. Great. Thank you. Who else has a question? Yes.
Thank you. we see that women are especially vulnerable in the U.S. and abroad, yet there seem to be so few female voices of influence in the Christian sphere and community. So my question is, how do we encourage Christian female leaders in fields like justice, international development, and entrepreneurship?
Thank you. And who else has another question? Yes, Jared.
Jared Netzel with Bread for the World. My question to both of you is, how does all this conversation around the role of the church interact with more international intentions? Especially, I'm thinking 2015 is the end of the Millennium Development Goals. We're talking about what's going to be the post-2015 agenda. I'm sure that both of your organizations are very much interested in that conversation. I'd love to hear your thoughts on how we as Christians interact with that larger strategy.
Thanks. Victor, any comments on any of those?
Let me start with the last one first. I think the Millennium Development Goals are a great example of this, of a way that the church can sort of raise its voice. The Millennium Development Goals, for those who are not familiar, is sort of a blueprint for development. The first one came out in 2000, and now we're sort of re-upping those goals in 2015. One of the great disappointments of the 2000 goals was that there was actually really no serious focus on the everyday violence that takes place in the developing world. And as Gary and I were preparing the research for the book, we noticed that many of the people on the ground said, we're having trouble meeting our benchmarks because they're constantly undermined by violence. And so I think you can go even to the Locust Effect website, and there's like an online petition that you could do in 2 minutes, anybody in the church could do this, that would just say to the authors of the Millennium Development Goals, we need to have violence on the agenda. So that's just a one easy example where the church can, in 2 minutes, make its voice known about the priority of violence in development.
Okay, Rich, any thoughts on any of those three questions?
Yeah, first of all, I applaud the young lady asking the question about gender. I'm here with my wife today, and she says, it's scandalous that there are no women speakers here today, and all the men are talking about gender. She had my wife come up here and talk, because she could say a thing or two about that. But I'm really encouraged that a lot of the young people here are women. And I find, as I sometimes speak on college campuses, that it's almost disproportionately women who come and are interested in these topics, and poverty, justice, and the things that are obviously so important to me in World Vision. So I see a great future for women in this, and I really encourage women to get involved in all of these fields related to poverty, justice, law, government, and I think this next generation is already on the right track. In terms of the role of the church and the MDGs, I want to say that I think it is almost to the church's shame that we weren't the ones that thought up the MDGs. The church, Tom and I talked about this earlier in the day, the church has a way sometimes, and I'm generalizing obviously grossly, but of being very suspicious of anything secular, and it seems to be very popular to really dislike the United Nations in the church. Maybe the U.S. government and the United Nations even worse, or be suspicious of those things. And I think we've got to get over the insularity that we cannot do the kind of work that we do in partnership with the government or the United Nations or some of the other secular institutions. Frankly, these problems in the world are so massive and so big that we will only solve them if we work together. So I talk about people of good faith being willing to work with people of goodwill for the common good. Jim's written a book on that. And I just think it's important. And I think in the MDG process going forward, the church really needs to start to have its own vision for a different and better world. And not just rely on the United Nations to do the kind of work that the church and the deepest thinkers in the church ought to be doing. So, and the church is really underrepresented in terms of advocacy. There's so much the church can do in advocacy, as Victor indicated. The voice of the American church is so powerful. If we could get 10% of the churches in America to speak on any issue, Congress would vote on it this week if we could literally mobilize that much support within the church. We didn't really address the first gentleman's question, but...
You want
Well, you know, how do you communicate to the government and the church about these issues and the nuance of communication? I think it's a real challenge. My writing, the two books I've written, have been geared to the church. I'm trying to shake the Magic Kingdom Church up a little bit to get them to see the world through a little bit different lens so that they will take more action and be more generous and do more things in the world instead of being trapped in the Magic Kingdom. In terms of speaking to government, I do have a meeting with Raj Shah next week at USAID to talk about some of the roles of the government and how we, but we work with the U.S. government on poverty alleviation. But often the politics of Washington really hamstring our foreign assistance programs in many ways. So I've known several USAID administrators, and they all feel pretty well wrapped up in barbed wire. They have very little flexibility in terms of what they can really do to shape a holistic view of poverty alleviation and injustice because there are so many strings attached to the congressional appropriations. Having said that, our government does a lot of good in the world through foreign assistance programs.
Well, if I can follow up on that briefly, given that we are here at AEI, a place where people are, you know, appropriately concerned with where their tax, where our tax dollars go, how indispensable is U.S. government leadership in addressing these issues for each of you? What would the situation be with if there was a sharply diminished U.S. government commitment? Is there evidence that the church and private citizens would step in to fill that? Would you say, Victor?
I think that the involvement of the U.S. government is very, very important in prioritizing the role of making public justice systems in the developing world work for the poor. And we can see that in a sense in the ways in which we have made developing world public justice systems work when it comes to spillover crimes. So when it comes to gun trafficking, drug trafficking, international terrorism, or when it comes to protecting elites or contract property rights, there we've developed the investments that actually make public justice systems work. But when we sort of tried to do a pretty careful look at where does the rule of law money go, we couldn't find 1% of U.S. funding that actually goes toward making public justice systems function to protect the poor from everyday violence. So that's good news and bad news. The bad news is we haven't done much, but the good news is it's not that it's been, to borrow kind of from Chesterton, it's not that it's been tried and found impossible, it's that it's been found hard and left untried. And in our case, we found that, you know, there's been some appropriate fears about investing in developing world public justice systems. It's not a benign system. I mean, it's not a benign system. And yet the solution to bad law enforcement is not no law enforcement. And I think the U.S. can play a really important role in reshifting those priorities.
Thanks. Rich, any thoughts on that?
Well, I think we need to recognize that the government plays a very important role globally. And again, you've got to attack these problems from the top down and the bottom up. And it's only through governmental intervention that you can really speak to other nation states and you know, legislate treaties and peace accords and different, you know, aid packages. So government to government is a very important level of communication. There's also a grassroots side to things where NGOs and voluntary organizations like World Vision and World Relief and Samaritan's Purse and others can be very effective as well in dealing with epidemics like Ebola and other social issues. So it's really a both and you know, we all kind of have a love-hate relationship with the government. You know, you can't live with them and you can't live without them. So there are things I'd love to see the government do better and more of, but the government is a very important player, and I think we have to be careful in the church not to be so suspicious of anything from the government that it can't be good, because USAID saves a lot of lives around the world, and we would, if we, our aid budget is less than 0.5% of the federal budget, and I've often dreamed if we spent even 1% more on foreign assistance, how many friends we could make around the world, and how we might prevent things like ISIS and Al-Qaeda and things like that from happening because of the economic development and the culture we could promote around the world if we just invested a little bit more.
So to conclude, because I know we have to wrap up shortly, I think one of the real challenges in working in this space is that of discouragement and this sense that nothing really changes, that things don't get any better. And I would say this afflicts people of faith as well as everybody else, because indeed these challenges are very daunting. One resource I would point out from my own organization, the Gates Foundation, is an annual letter that Bill Gates and Bill and Melinda Gates write together each year. This year was on myths around international development. And the very first one is that nothing gets better, that things just stay how they are. And that is very much a myth. In the health space, for example, the incredible advances over the last two generations are, I think, a great untold story that very few people know. The next myth they addressed was that programs, international programs run by governments like the U.S. government, really don't have an impact because we don't really know what works. And I think that's another place where there's been tremendous progress in recent years. The PEPFAR program, that is the Global AIDS Initiative, where I used to work, you know, is now supporting treatment for something on the order of 6 million people. And AIDS is a disease that, when you have it, without the treatment, you will die. So those are 6 million people who would otherwise be dead and are alive today. So it certainly, believe me, I know, having been inside, there's all kinds of problems, but there is also tremendous progress that's happening. And I think those are some of the things that I have in mind when I try to avoid discouragement. Any brief comments from either of you on that discouragement question before we close?
Yeah, I would just say, too, that as we think about the problem of violence, there are two great points of encouragement. One is just the hope of history, that when you start looking at reasonably functioning public justice systems in the developed world, in the Magic Kingdom, you find out that they used to be tragic kingdom public justice systems, almost indistinguishable from what you see in the developing world today, just 100, 150 years ago. And so it turns out that functioning public justice systems don't just fall from heaven. They are fought for and built, and each of those has a story. And we tell the story of those systems in New York and Chicago and LA and Seattle and Paris and London and Tokyo that were once really, really broken systems. So that's one point of encouragement. The other is just these little demonstration projects of hope. In fact, one funded by the Gates Foundation, where they gave a seed grant and said, we're going to do a baseline study of victimization and see if we can reduce violence by 20% in 4 years in the category of child sex trafficking. And using the interventions to sort of help law enforcement stand up. No major change in poverty, but helping law enforcement stand up. In 4 years, there was a 79% reduction in child victimization of sex trafficking. And so we're starting to see these little incubation projects that really are demonstrating that this is not impossible. It just hasn't been really incubated and scaled up yet.
Yeah, and I would just say, to add to that, we don't do a very good job of celebrating the victories. And as I said from the podium, the progress made against poverty in the last 25 years is unprecedented in the world. I mean, I could give you a whole list of statistics, but maternal mortality has been cut in half. Child mortality has fallen from 40,000 children a day to less than 18,000. Malaria is in retreat. The HIV/AIDS pandemic has been largely controlled. It's still there, obviously, but there is so much that is working and so much to celebrate. Just since 1990, 2 billion people have received clean water. There's less than 1 billion people left on Earth that don't have clean water. And just 25 years ago, it was 2.8 billion. And then just something from a spiritual standpoint, that as Christians, it is not an option for us to give up or to be discouraged or to walk away because it's too hard. I'll leave you with one of my favorite quotes from Mother Teresa, when she was asked by a young reporter in Calcutta if she hadn't been a failure, because she'd spent her whole life in Calcutta, and arguably there were more poor people at the end of her life than there were at the beginning. She pointed her finger at him and she said, "Young man, my God did not call me to be successful. He called me to be obedient." And I think as Christians, we have to, success is a goal, but obedience is required. And it doesn't matter how many times we fail, we must be obedient and leave the victory to God.
Thank you both very much.